Hello, I'm Kimberlie, and welcome to the weekend edition of the Nave News Update. It's Friday, November 7th. Many of the stories you hear here can be found at IndianCountryNews.com. And here's the news for the day from the Associated Press and other Native news sources. During November, the nation pays homage to the contributions of Native Americans throughout history. Part of that history is a legacy of military service. Many tribes were involved in the War of 1812, and they fought for both sides as auxiliary troops in the Civil War. Native Americans have served in every major American conflict and continue to serve in operations around the globe. According to the Defense Department statistics, they have the highest per capita commitment of any ethnic population to serve in the armed forces. To date, 28 Native Americans have received the Medal of Honor, with the most recent being Army Private First Class Charles George, a member of the Cherokee Nation. He was recognized for saving members of his unit during the Korean War by throwing himself on a grenade and absorbing the explosion. The Charles George Veterans Affairs Medical Center in Asheville, North Carolina, is named in his honor. Major General Clarence L. Tinker, a member of the Osage Nation, was the first Native American in U.S. history to attain the rank of Major General and the first American general to die in World War II. Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma is named in his honor. And Specialist Lori Ann Piestewa, a member of the Hopi tribe, was the first Native American woman in history to die in combat while serving with the U.S. military and the first woman in the U.S. Armed Forces killed in the 2003 invasion of Iraq. Arizona's Piestewa Peak is named in her honor. According to the Library of Congress, what started at the turn of the century as an effort to gain a day of recognition for the significant contributions the first Americans made to the establishment and growth of the U.S. has resulted in a whole month being designated for that purpose. One of the very proponents of an American Indian Day was Dr. Arthur C. Parker, a member of the Seneca Nation, who was the director of the Museum of Arts and Science in Rochester, New York. He persuaded the Boy Scouts of America to set aside a day for the first Americans, and for 3 years they adopted such a day. In 1990, President George W. Bush approved a joint resolution designating November 1990 National American Indian Heritage Month. Similar proclamations under variants in the name have been issued every year since 1994. And in following suit with every president before him since 1994, on October 31st, President Obama proclaimed November 2014 as National Native American Heritage Month and November 28th as National Native American Heritage Day. As communities across the country honor our heritage this month, my hopes are that we also take a moment and remember those who have passed that fought for our rights, like Ingrid Washinawatok, an internationally known member of the Menominee Nation, who was murdered on March 4, 1999 by FARC guerrillas in Colombia. An Anime Pictuakwash, a member of the Mi'kmaq Nation, a Native rights activist who was kidnapped, raped, and executed by members of the American Indian Movement around December 12, 1975. How many missing until you start listening, chanted protesters on October 4th as they marched in Montreal, asking why, after almost a decade, the Canadian government has continued to overlook the disappearances and deaths of Indigenous women. Activists estimate that 60% of the 3,000 women who have gone missing or murdered in Canada since 1980 are Indigenous, with hundreds of cases still unsolved. Over 1,000 people came to the 9th Annual March and Vigil for Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women, organized by Missing Justice Quebec Native Women and the Center for Gender Advocacy, to demand justice for missing and murdered Indigenous women and call on the Canadian government to investigate the violence against them. The march was one of around 100 Sister in Spirit events held across Canada in protest of these issues. Bridget Tolley, an Algonquin woman, on the anniversary of her mother's death, founded this march 9 years ago. Gladys Tolley died in 2001 after being hit by a Quebec police cruiser. No inquiry was made into the case and no officers were charged in her death. On August 13th, the Native Women's Association of Canada released the digital life story of Hillary Bunnell. 16-year-old Hillary Bunnell went missing after attending a house party on Burnt Church First Nation on September 5, 2009. Her cousin Curtis Bunnell was found guilty in November of 2012 of first-degree murder in her death. The offense carries an automatic life sentence with no parole eligibility for 25 years. Earlier this year, he appealed his conviction and was seeking a new trial. On April 29, 2014, after hearing arguments in the case from Bunnell's lawyer and the Crown prosecutor, a New Brunswick Court of Appeals justice reserved a decision.
My name is Pamela Fillier, and this is my husband, Fred Fillier, who is also Hillary's stepfather. She was a good little girl. She loved to dance, sing, loved posing for the camera, loved the camera.
To watch the full version of the digital life story of Hillary Bunnell, you can go to YouTube and search the title. Recently, Hillary's mom, Pamela Fillier, reached out to Indian Country TV, saying that ever since she has lost her daughter, she has wanted to do something to honor her. She would like to be able to create and host a show on missing and murdered Aboriginal women, and is looking for resources to help make that dream a reality. In a first for MTV, the stories of Frank Wallen, Inez Jasper, Natani Means and Mike Clifford, young Native American activist musicians, will be at the center of Rebel Music Native America. The film showcases the four as they draw from their heritage, using art to expose and overcome issues affecting their communities, environment, and selves.
As Indigenous peoples all over the world, we've been dehumanized so much. And this music is a powerful tool to express our humanity.
This is our community. Who gave them the permission to come through the reservation?
They're still trying to colonize our land. It's just happening in new ways.
You're all Lakotas. Stand up for your rights.
This land and our families are some of the few things we have left.
There's such a long history about Indigenous women being abused and mistreated. There's thousands of missing and murdered Indigenous women in this land. A big part of our female sensuality and sexuality have been threatened in such a negative way. It's really important to embrace and reclaim our identity as human beings in a safe way.
The nearly 30-minute premiere episode of Rebel Music's second season will debut exclusively on the brand's Facebook page on November 13th. Rebel Music Native America's promotional trailer, which highlights AIM leader Russell Means as a hero, has caught the attention of Denise Pictou Maloney, the daughter of Annie Mae Aquash. Denise posted the following on MTV's posting of the trailer. You know, it is really too bad these young people don't know their history and truth and unknowingly or knowingly perpetrate the vicious cycle against innocence by glorifying and ignoring the injustices in their own backyards. Russell Means is no hero. Denise's mother, Annie Mae Pictou Aquash, a member of the Mi'kmaq Nation from Nova Scotia, Canada, was more than just a Native rights activist during the 1970s. She was a woman, a mother of two young girls, a daughter, a wife, sister, and friend, who was kidnapped, raped, and then executed by members of the American Indian Movement in December of 1975. And that's another roundup of news from Indian Country on this edition of the Native News Update. I'd like to thank you for joining me, and have a grand day.